អង្គុយចុះអង្គជំនឿប្រកាសបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសមាការអសនការនៅថ្ងៃនេះអង្គជំនឿធ្វើសមាការបន្តស្ដាប់សកម្មកម្មសក្តិអ្នកជំនាញហងរីលូកាក្លាមជាសមាការកញ្ញាជាសិរហងឡារីការអំពីស្ថានភាពវត្តមានអវត្តមានគីនឹងបុគ្គលដែលអង្គជំនឿក៏អញ្ជើញចូលរួមនៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសមាការថ្ងៃនេះ
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសម្រាប់សមាការនៅថ្ងៃនេះក្លាមជាកាត់សម្គាល់ឃើញថាគ្រប់ភាគីទាំងអស់នៃរឿងក្តីនេះមានវត្តមានដោយឡែកលោកនួនជាមានវត្តមាននៅបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនខាងក្រោមសាសនាការនេះដែលលោកស្នាសុំលះបង្សិតមានវត្តមានដែលតល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សាសនាការនៅថ្ងៃនេះលិខិតលះបង្សិតរបស់លោកនួនជាបានប្រគល់ដល់កាលាបញ្ជីរួចហើយអ្នកជំនាញដែលត្រូវមកផ្ដល់សក្ខីកម្មនៅថ្ងៃនេះគឺលោក HENRI លូកាតលោកមានវត្តមានរួចហើយនៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សាសនាការនេះសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធាន
អរគុណកញ្ញាជាស៊ីហងជាដបងនេះអង្គជំនះសម្ដេចលើសំណើសុំរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាជាមុនសិនអង្គជំនះបានទទួលលិខិតសំលៀកបងសិទ្ធចូលរួមក្នុងសកម្មភាពដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបទបសកម្មភាពនេះរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាចុះថ្ងៃទី1ខែសីហាឆ្នាំ2016ដែលបានបញ្ជាក់ថាដែលគាត់មានបញ្ហាសុខភាពឈឺក្បាលឈឺចង្កេះមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបានមិនអាចផ្ចង់អារម្មណ៍បានយូរនិងដើម្បីមានលទ្ធភាពចូលរួមសកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃខាងមុខឲ្យមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពខ្លួនសំលៀកបងសិទ្ធចូលរួមនឹងវត្តមានដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបទបសកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃទី1ខែសីហាឆ្នាំ2016មេធាវីការក្តីរបស់ខ្លួនបានប្រាប់អំពីផលប៉ះពាល់នៃការលះបង់សិទ្ធិនេះថាការលះបង់សិទ្ធិនេះមិនអាចបកស្រាយថាជាការលះបង់សិទ្ធិរបស់ខ្លួនក្នុងការកាត់ក្តីដោយយុត្តិធម៌ឬក៏សិទ្ធិក្នុងការទន្ទាស់តវ៉ាទៅនឹងភស្តុតាងក្នុងការដាក់បង្ហាញឬដាក់ជូនតុលាការនេះគ្រប់ពេលវេលានៃសកម្មភាពលើរូបខ្លួនឡើយបានឃើញកំណត់ហេតុវិនិច្ឆ័យសុខភាពជូនជាប់ចោតនូនជាដែលធ្វើឡើងដោយគ្រូពេទ្យប្រចាំការវិនិច្ឆ័យព្យាបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជូនជាប់ចោតនៅអវតកចុះថ្ងៃទី1ខែសីហាឆ្នាំ2016បានកត់សម្គាល់ពីស្ថានភាពសុខភាពរបស់លោកនុនជានៅថ្ងៃនេះថាមានអាការៈឈឺចង្កេះខ្លាំងពិសេសពេលអង្គុយយូរពលមុខពេលមានការបំផ្លាស់បដូរស្ថានភាពនិងបានផ្ដល់អនុសាសន៍ថាសូមឲ្យអង្គជំរះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកនុនជាចូលរួមតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសមាការពីបន្ទប់មួយថិតក្រោមសាលសមាការនេះហើយលើមូលដ្ឋាននេះនឹងយោងតាមរដ្ឋបញ្ញត្តិនៃវិធាន815នៃវិធានទីក្នុងអវតកអង្គជំរះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យជួយជួយចោតនុនជាចូលរួមនៅតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសមាការពីចម្ងាយគឺវាបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនមួយថែក្រោមសាសនការនេះតាមរយៈឧបករណ៍សោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់រយៈពេលសនការពេញមួយថ្ងៃនេះឧបករណ៍បុគ្គលិកផ្នែកសោទស្សន៍ជួបប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់ជំនួយនុនជាអាចចូលរួមនៅតាមបានកិច្ចដំណើរការសនការពីថ្ងៃក្នុងឡុងពេលនៃកិច្ចដំណើរការសនការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះមុននឹងផ្ដល់វិធានការជូនទៅភាគីថាមិទ្ធិវិនមុខតំណាងដើមនឹងរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីបន្តការតាំងសម្រួលទៅដល់ចំពោះអ្នកជំនាញហងជំរះចេញដែលសម្រាប់ក្រុមមាត់ឬសំណើសុំរបស់វិទ្យាវិការវិក្តីនួនជាអនុលោមតាមវិធាន873និង874នៃវិធានទីក្នុងនៅថ្ងៃទី29ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2016វិទ្យាវិការវិក្តីនួនជាបានស្នើសុំឲ្យទទួលយកជាឯកសារផ្ទតាងនៅមេតិកានៃនិខេបបទបណ្ឌិតរបស់អ្នកជំនាញហងរីលូកាដែលមានចំណងជើងថាទស្សនវិស័យនៃការសម្រាប់មកទៀលនិងមរុគមវិជាក្រោមរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យពីថ្ងៃទី17ខែមេសាឆ្នាំ1975ដល់ថ្ងៃទី7ខែមករាឆ្នាំ1979ដែលមានលេខ EON 013795 រហូតដល់013797611នឹងអត្ថបទមួយទៀតដែលគាត់បាននិពន្ធមានចំណងជើងថាចរិតលក្ខណៈនៃការគៀបសង្កត់នៅក្នុងរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យដែលមានលេខ EON 013797662រហូតដល់013797971លោកហងរាវកាបានផ្ដល់ឯកសារទាំងពីរនេះមកឲ្យជំរះហើយត្រូវបានដាក់ចូលទៅក្នុងឃ្លាំងទុកឯកសាររួមនៅថ្ងៃទី26ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2016អង្គជំរះបានស្ដាប់សារណាផ្ទាល់មាត់របស់ភាគីនានាលើសំណើនេះនៅថ្ងៃទី29ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2016ហើយភាគីផ្សេងផ្សេងទៀតមិនបានជំទាស់ចំពោះសំណើសុំនេះទេអង្គជំរះក៏សម្គាល់ពីលក្ខខណ្ឌតម្រូវនៃវិធាន87 ហើយដូច្នេះអង្គញឹមរះសម្រេចតាមដំណើរសុំរបស់មេធាវីការពារក្តីនួនជាមេតិការនៃនិខេបបត
ជាបន្តទៅនេះអង្គមេផ្ដាល់ប្រកាសជូនទៅក្រមសហមន្ត្រីនមុខតំណាងដើមនឹងរដ្ឋនេះដើម្បីសួរបញ្ចប់ចំពោះអ្នកជំនាញតាមនៃការវិភាគសម្រាប់ផ្ដាល់ឲ្យខ្លួនបាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានសូមគោរពលោកស្រីចៅក្រម អង្គសវនាការទាំងមូលសូមជម្រាបសួរដល់លោកសាក់សីខ្ញុំមានសំណួរមួយចំនួនទៀតសម្រាប់សួរនៅពេលនេះដល់លោកសំណួររបស់ខ្ញុំជាដំបូងពេលនេះគឺចង់សួរថាដោយសារលោកបានសិក្សាអំពីមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខនានានៅក្នុងប្រជាណាចក្រកម្ពុជា ខ្ញុំចង់ដឹងថាមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខដែលប្រកាសឡើងនៅក្នុងសម័យ75ដល់79ហ្នឹងថាតើគេរៀបចំយ៉ាងដូចម្ដេចគេរៀបចំតាមថ្នាក់ស្រុកថ្នាក់ខេត្តឬក៏ថ្នាក់ឃុំឲ្យមានមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខហ្នឹង
Yes, as I explain in many documents that I have published, as I have read myself, the prison system is essentially based on the district. The district was the fundamental administrative division in democratic Kampuchea. It included a number of sahakor, or people's communes, which tended over the regime to become larger and larger, that is, including more and more villages. As the evidence that was presented in this court last week, and documents that were handed to me concerning Kramkok district, we know that it was the duty of the three officials who manage the Sahakor, the people's communes, to identify the enemies. They were therefore arrested by the TROP or by the local militia. They were taken to the local police station, the local police station at the Sahakor level. Based on these interrogations, some could have been released, but mostly they were sent to the district. So the core institution of the prison system was certainly, no doubt, the district. Which level exactly it's hard to say. I think this court, in the past 8 years,
has
found out, or found more and more evidence that security was one of the first duties of the entire state, or revolutionary state, or party state, and therefore directives were given at the top of the chain of command
to identify
all along the administrative divisions of the Cambodia to identify the enemies of the revolution. So this was, of course, initiated by the center and down over the chain of command, that is, Phumphea, Lombok, Srok, and Sahakor. Yes, as we have seen in the case of Tram Kok,
I think that
the right to smash or annihilate or contact the enemies was delegated from the center as it has been explained at length in this tribunal to the regions,
I'm not so sure
that it played a vital role, but certainly to the district.
And therefore, it is
at the district level that the decision to execute
or to free or to send to execute or to free
Again, as it has been, I think, repeated a number of times over this long trial, and from what I found as early as 1989, when I first met Mueang Son in Lyon and his wife, Pally.
Mueang Son, as I
explained, from Kompong Som, from Sihanoukville. He recognized also a couple, I think, of ex-monks. In other words, it was what I called in my slogan the elite of the past. A communist revolution is about changing the elite, smashing, destroying, or sending into exile, or putting in prison, or whatever, the old elite, and replacing it by the new elite. So that was the situation, 75, 76, then when he was arrested, when he was arrested the second time, at the end of 1977, he was very surprised to see around him in his knot again. But this time, there was quite a few Khmer Rouge Kamapibal, including some of the people he had met earlier at Panay, soldiers, and the rest being either Prachichun Thmey or Prachichun Chak. In other words, It was all social classes, and in particular, a significant percentage of Khmeres themselves. And I think that I already said at that tribunal that it seems to me that eternal purges were getting out of control. And as the months went by, the superior organization decided were more and more suspicious of its own rank and file and processed them through the prison system from S21 down to the smallest district prison.
Look, man, mean Sam Bang, many Manu del Chop song site, drug band keep a tune, termities and sock. Had I had a white band here, Manu del Chop car song site, and tell you, come with Tony Cap a tune, termities and sock to know.
Yes, it's a bit of a mystery why were majority of the people not summarily executed. It seems that it was a waste of time, a lot of manpower, energy, and resources for a regime which had an obsession of the super great leap forward, in other words, bring prosperity and abundance as soon as possible and faster than any other countries in the world. Well, the reason was that individuals no longer existed under democratic Cambodia. The individual, as I explained in the last chapter of my collection of slogans, had to merge into the collective. Everything was collective, and every individual was just one small atom of a big machine, which was
Locard. Therefore,
when somebody looked suspicious, looked that he was not very fond of the regime, or had been trying to run away, or had done something illegal according to revolutionary morality, he could not have acted alone. Individual decisions were unheard of. Therefore, he necessarily must have been part of a plot, of a network, of people who were conspiring against the revolution. Therefore, before he was killed, it was essential that he confessed and that he gave out names and names of all his network. And this was the process in S21, this is the same process at the district. So killing people outright was vital information lost for the safety, the security of the revolution.
Look, perhaps you've been successful in the network. មន្ទីរសន្តិសុខផ្សេងៗម្សិលមិញលោកបានមានប្រសាសន៍អំពីរបបអាហារដែលពួកគាត់ទទួលហើយក៏ខ្ញុំចង់សួរបញ្ជាក់អំពីការរស់នៅរបស់ពួកគាត់នៅក្នុងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខលោកអាចពិពណ៌នាបានទេគាត់រស់នៅរបៀបយ៉ាងដូចម្តេចនៅក្នុងមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខនោះ
Yes, by and large, it seems to me, after listening to all the details about S21, that the living conditions in the provincial prisons were even worse than at S21. Worse insofar as usually inmates were not allowed to wash. Of course, it's extremely difficult to generalize on democratic Cambodia, as keep telling that it was chaos. Some places organized such a way, others differently. So you do see sometimes certain prisoners in certain district prisons who were allowed to wash in a small river or eventually a small shower. But by and large, there were not washed. While at S21, a hose of water was thrown all over The food was very simple. It was the same diet throughout Cambodia: bobo, rice, soup, twice a day, and a very small amount. Such a small amount that usually, after 3 or 4 weeks, the people could not survive. So, this apparently was not the really not quite as bad as S21, because some prisoners did survive up to 3, 4, 5, and even 6 months. So, I think the diet was a bit more substantial. At S21. So, from my research, I can say that the living conditions, and of course there was no medical care whatsoever in all the provincial prisons. So I think the living conditions could have been even worse than at S21.
ខ្ញុំនៅមានសំណួរបន្តិចបន្តួចទេ
Nothing of that sort. They were usually sleeping directly on cement or on tiles or even on earth, as was the case in Tanay prison, Mungson's prison, where in the case that the prison was purpose-built of long huts. So, and of course, no pillows, no mosquito net, and they were bitten by insects, particularly as they were sweating and they were dirty. So the poor people were living in the most unhygienic imaginable circumstances, provided also that you had to take into account that they could not relieve themselves, go out to relieve themselves. So they had, you know, tins that were passing around, all that sort of thing. I've never seen, as I just said, any example of any medical treatment in the provincial prisons. Now, the inmates were kept quite much shorter time than in S21. The average that I think I wrote is something like 3 weeks. And I had to add to the diet. The bobo was so real, that is so light, that you could only survive
3-4 weeks, a month, a maximum, and lots of people died of famine at night.
But some noise on crowd box him. Net to the ban, when June children clung Montes and sock. Time the yakka, socks, and repeat about look, look at a panda man bante, book got slap. Punman Pierroy, the little gym noons rob that when June children on Montes and sock. Same saying.
The percentage who died, well, you could die in three ways. You died of famine, of hunger, in your knot, as I just mentioned. Secondly, you died under interrogation. And you have examples of ex-marriage interrogators who said this person died.
And you remember the executions neatly and thoroughly, as it had to be done secretly.
Very few, as I said, managed to
free and escape, very few, but
as to the percentage of the prisoners who were in fact released, as I said earlier, more numerous in the early stages of the revolutionary regime and fewer in the last stages of the regime.
But I think that in every local prison, not very many,
not more than 3-5%
ខ្ញុំយល់ឃើញថាអ្នកតោដែលត្រូវបានដោះលែងនឹងមិនលើសពី3 ទៅ4%ទេបាទសូមអរគុណលោកអ្នកជំនាញដែលបានឆ្លើយចំពោះសំណួររបស់ខ្ញុំសូមគោរពលោកប្រធានខ្ញុំអរសំណួរសូមអរគុណបាទតទៅទៀតខ្ញុំទួចក្រុមលោកច្រើនសំឡេងសំឡេងមានសំណួរបាទបាទមិនមានសំណួរទេតទៅនេះអត់មានផ្ដល់លោកការជូនទៅ
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours.
Good morning, Council.
Just for the record, Mr. President, I'm starting at
9:30,
Mr. President, I'm starting at 9:30. Let me try to narrow down what your actual expertise is.
Do you agree with me that you are not an expert in psychiatry?
Yes, absolutely.
So when you're saying that Nguyen Chia is either schizophrenic, power hungry,
Not quite, because I'm merely repeating what I read from recognized academics. There's a French psychiatrist who wrote the biography of Robespierre. Escapes me for the time being, but he wrote a remarkable Robespierre, and he's using, that is a psychiatrist himself and was the head of a psychiatry department in a big hospital in Paris, and he was using that kind of term. So in that case, I'm merely repeating the diagnosis of other people.
Do you agree with me that you are also not an expert in the field of demographics?
Sorry, I finished answering the preceding question. I mentioned the Dr.
Jean
Artarit. A-R-T-A-R-I-T. Jean Artarit, and I refer to you to his famous Robespierre, who was very much admired by the Khmer leadership. As to am I not being a demographer, yes, I agree. I merely use the work of other people, and in particular, Marek Sivinsky's book, Khmer Rouge Genocide. I'm merely repeating the findings. First of Sivinsky, and second of the court itself.
Do you also agree with me that you are not an expert in agriculture?
Policy of 3 tons of hectare. Of DK or CPK, that is just your personal opinion, correct?
Yes and no. Yes, insofar I was not trained in political science. Yes, insofar as I have no degree to produce in political science. No, insofar as I have taught, specialist of British civilization, and I've taught British history for many decades, and I've taught specifically on the British political system,
which personally I learned under Khmer.
When I started my research on democratic Kampuchea, 1989, so that's more than 25 years ago, I read almost important books about totalitarianism. I also taught the Institute of Political Studies in New York, specifically a course on democratic Kampuchea, and it was basically around the notion of totalitarianism and crime against humanity. So you can, I can claim that I have no degrees to produce. I've got some ideas and some practice. And you learn as you practice, as the Khmer would say, and lay some truth in that.
Certainly.
Locard, have you ever heard of something called peer review?
Yes, I'm not sure the translator understood you, so you could give perhaps an equivalent review of other academics. Of course I know about that. I had peer review continuously, particularly when I took my PhD, which was in French sur travaux. It was about the books I had written and the articles that I had written. My research was continuously reviewed by other people. No later than Saturday, I had a French academic who came to my house and absolutely wants me to write another book. So I think that some, particularly the Khmer slogans, have been very much appreciated. And although my second edition was published more than 10 years ago, it's still found in the bookshops. And I had some people who told some, I got some, a message saying that it was one of the most interesting books on democratic country. So I've been reviewed by the readers, by journalists, by academics, throughout my 25 to 26 years of
Maybe you could say,
Continuously, when books on democratic Cambodia came out, I published which I like very much. I did a review. François Bizot was grateful to me. He thought that what I was saying was François to Pizot the point. When Philippe Shaw produced the History of a Nightmare, I produced a review.
I'm not sure if we understand each other.
Yes, but it was mainly in French. I published a long, more than 50 pages review of the Bush trial, and also when the Black Book of Communism, Stefan Courtois, came out. It gave rise in France to a big controversy. So I published my own view about the black book of communism
and that review
was published also in communism.
One of my articles was published in
the International European Review, which was a paper of a conference that I had attended at Leeds in the early 2000s, and the subject was on genocide.
So
that was in English. Yes, I could have had more publications, certainly.
Is there any
specific reason that some of these publications I cannot find on your CV, which I believe you made in June 2016?
When you give a biography, you write your also your academic career, your publication, you did the main publications. I'm not sure if you have published at least an average number of articles.
We'll certainly get back to that in our closing submissions, Mr. Locard. Your main expertise.
On the first trial day,
11:15 in the morning, when you went to Cambodia in 1994,
were you then
a historian, or were you more someone who was in English?
Well, of course, English. But in an English department at the time, When I went to Cambodia, you are a bit confusing the dates. This is not 1994, but just the academic year 93-94. As at that time, I think it was 93, published the autobiography of Meng Son, and I think a very well published book with annotations, maps, evidence clearly organized, bank, and Cambodian studies, and my point was that the Ministry of Education gave me something which is quite exceptional in France, that is one sabbatical year. Sabbatical years are common in Britain, virtually non-existent in French universities.
But they considered that
what I'd done so far was sufficient for the French government to continue to give me a full salary
and
without any teaching obligations
in York. I was in New York.
Changing subjects is very unusual in the French-speaking world, but quite common in the English-speaking world. It is not because you specialized in a particular century or a specific subject that you cannot in your in the career of 40 years, and for me it has been 50 years, you're not allowed to move from one to the other. So I have been overseas perhaps for 25 years, and Cambodia especially is now for 25 years. I think there is no way to control both expertise, that is, English and history.
ជំនាញរបស់ខ្ញុំពីរគឺភាសាអង់គ្លេសផងនិងភាសានិងប្រវត្តិវិទ្យាផងលោកអ្នកជំនាញលោកអាចសុំឆ្លើយឲ្យខ្លីបន្តិចមកដោយសារតែខ្ញុំមិនមានពេលវេលាច្រើនទេសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះ
Yes and no.
Not in the least.
Sat for the defense of my PhD in the year 2000. I had a vast public, and some people said that is one of the most interesting defense that I attended.
But surely, academics should be in a position to verify the research that you have done. How did they in fact verify that you
Well, they must have, because there were four members in the board to examine. One of them was Khmer, specifically to verify that the translations of the slogans from Khmer into French were all right. And if they hadn't been satisfied, and they gave me the best for my PhD, with the félicitations du jury, the best honors you could have, and if they hadn't been satisfied, they would not have granted me the PhD title.
Tell me a bit more in detail. Did you write them with your notes?
Were they able to read your notes, to verify your notes,
I'm sorry, Mr. Lord. I think you make this court, but the people who are listening to me behind me waste their time by useless totally asking me totally useless questions. You said earlier that your time is limited. So if your time is limited, please ask me relevant questions.
I believe it's very relevant. As of now, it's been why we have to establish whether you have
expertise.
The question is irrelevant, therefore I will not answer it.
With all due respect, Mr. President, I want to make sure that
Well, if my collection of slogans were unacademic, stupid, again for fun, how is it that Silkworm books in Chiang Mai, a number of years later, asked me for publishing a second edition, which was corrected, enlarged, and printed that book at its own expenses and not mine, and sold quite a few copies. And how is it that this book, as far as I know, is still for sale at Monument Books here in Phnom Penh?
That is a really good question.
Let me move on. Did you try to somehow corroborate the interviews that you did with official, rather contemporaneous DK documents?
Did you study revolutionary flags, minutes of meetings, telegrams, historical
contemporaneous
documents?
Yes, I did, but my main primary sources, as you can see in my notes of Pol Pot's little red book, the English edition, where Foreign Broadcast Information Service, to which I was introduced during my research fellowship at the Australian Defence Force Academy.
Reports, the achievements of the regime. Let me ask it differently. Is it correct that when I go through your footnotes in your book on the slogans, I cannot find any reference to either Red Flags, Red Flags, and Minutes of the Division Commander, Son Sen, Telegram, etc. Is that correct?
Possibly. Because basically my research has been from the fieldwork, that is, from the democratic temperature regime, live from people in the Sahako.
So what I was interested in was
to be, to some extent, the mouthpiece of the people, on the one hand, and understand how they understood the regime, how they lived the regime, how they understand what was the propaganda,
I'm not saying there's anything wrong with reporting traditional oral history, but I'm a bit puzzled as to why we need to search for corroboration that might be the most important that is something that can nowhere be found in any
I look for corroboration, not at the top, not from the mouthpiece. I look for corroboration at the grassroots, that is, regionally, and looking onward. On the other hand, I think that in the vast literature on democratic capture, that particular slogan was quoted extensively. So it was certainly found one of my main sources, other academics have not sufficiently used, is people's testimonies. And I think I already said last week in this court that I have virtually read all testimonies that have been printed. The last one was published this year in France, and I've read it in the
same.
And in all those testimonies, you find slogans, and you find that type of slogan. And that's for me, that's sufficient.
It is my understanding that this particular saying is also a often used Chinese proverb in daily life. Let me follow up by quoting what you said yourself on the second day of your testimony last Friday, 10:58. In response to a certain slogan, you said, and I quote,
the question is whether it was invented by the revolution
or was it a small apparatchik who imagined it, end of quote. So having your own quote in the back of your mind, again, why was it that you didn't try to find corroboration in official publications?
Let me return the question to you. You're lucky enough to defend a character who was an extremely important personality under Democratic Kampuchea,
Some
of these words I mentioned are using the slogans are quite learned words from Pali and Sanskrit. Only quite highly educated people would have received them. So why don't you ask your own client?
People
around him,
It was a very simple question. Before I go to your individual sources, let me ask you first, do you know what confirmation bias means? Freely, I would say it's the tendency to interpret information so that it becomes compatible with existing beliefs and convictions. In other words, you filter out any new information that contradicts existing views. That is very briefly what confirmation bias is. And I'm asking this question because on the first day, testimony at 11:00, answering a question why you have done your research, you said, and I quote, to understand why there has been this catastrophic regime, end of quote. In other words, let me be concrete in my question. Knowing now what confirmation bias is, did you have this bias before you started your research?
Well, Well, I don't know about Holland from where you come. But I can tell you that in France, we are taught from early childhood to exercise our critical thinking and put into question everything that we are told in books and particularly by politicians. We always, we never stop criticizing and criticizing and criticizing. So when I hear, for instance, that the Khmer Rouge destroyed everything, no longer last Saturday, this Frenchman who interviewed me. Yes, how much destruction was there in Phnom Penh?
I answered, hardly
anything was destroyed in Phnom Penh under Democratic Kampuchea. Oh, and he was very very surprised. Because the standard view is that the Khmer Rouge destroyed everything. And I'm sorry, this is my training. I've always doubted before any fact is established, you have to have very concrete evidence and at least from three different quarters. So to come back to Phnom Penh, I said yes, the Khmer Rouge destroyed absolutely the Catholic Cathedral. There was a block of flats, you know, where you have the huge towers now that was destroyed. You have the National Bank, which we don't even know exactly the circumstances of destruction of the National Bank. But that was all the pagodas of Phnom Penh have survived. All the pagodas of Siem Reap have survived, and the Khmer Rouge destroyed far fewer pagodas that is being repeated again and again. It has been repeated by the Democratic Kampuchea, the People's Republic of Kampuchea, that thousands and thousands and thousands of monks were killed. No. Comparatively, few monks were killed. They were all defrocked, but the majority of the monks were not killed. The country was an agricultural revolution. And there was no agricultural revolution, there was no industry. No! The Khmer Rouge revived absolutely every industrial complex and created new ones. Their obsession was super great leap into industry. You had the big rubber factory of Thạch Mau, which was in full operation under the Khmer Rouge, and shut down by the Vietnamese occupation and never reopened. So precisely, I think the Khmer Rouge have committed enough crimes, and I'm always very angry when I hear that they inflicted crimes that they did not commit. Well, I'll give you another example, which was rape. Now, I think this tribunal has listed rape as one of the crimes,
In the first place, I
thought it was strange because as rule number 6 of the code of ethics of the party was strictly not to do anything wrong with a woman, I thought that rapes were more strictly controlled in that regime than in other periods of including our present time. Then I realized, looking through my notes, the 10% of the victims of the prison system, basically, which were 90% were men, 10%. In many cases, before executions, and I found evidence of that in the East region and some in Battambang, that systematically the women, before they were executed by the torturers, were raped. So they asked the head of the Kongchalat to execute the women.
This is about a prison in Trump Kong. You refer to a certain person called Uk Kaila. Uk Kaila tells a horrific story about rape. This narrative of Kaila proves to be both vague, horrendous, and probably largely imagined or from details collected from hearsay after the fall of the revolutionary regime. Uk Kaila is a strong supporter and beneficiary of the RK regime. Now this, I believe, only example possibly a mechanism to avoid confirmation bias. Do you remember why in this particular case you wrote this down?
Can you give me the date? Was it not the early 90s? 1991?
Interviewed on the 11th July
1991. Well, this was the first year in which I launched into this adventure. Normally, I was doing the work of an anthropologist. I was improvising, learning as you go. I had limited freedom of movement, and I was sometimes confronted by witnesses who had been manipulated by the long period of 1979-1991 of pro-Vietnamese regime. I remember in particular that was, I think, in in Svai Rieng, Information and culture first when you arrive in a district and asked about the investigation that had been made of the local prisons and if they could provide witnesses.
Now, some of the witnesses,
I'm not sure that I'm being heard, yes. Some of the witnesses obviously were genuine and had not been trained by the PRK regime. Some of them I had met, so I expressed my doubts. Gradually over the years, I was freer with my movement, and therefore I did not depend so much on the local authorities.
And my last question,
Mr. President.
I hear what you say, Mr. Locard, but how are we in a position to verify the accuracy or even the product value of the sources? How can we do
that? Well, simply, what the local lawyer or every historian does by corroborating, comparing with other sources, that's all.
បាទអរគុណអរគុណអ្នកជំនាញឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសម្រាប់ហើយឲ្យប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីពេលនេះទៅទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 10:40នាទីសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសន្និការមន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលការត្រង់រូបរកកន្លែងសម្រាប់នៅបន្ទប់រងចាំនៃមេផ្សាក់ស្័យដល់ផ្សាក់ស្័យជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងឡុងពេលជប់សម្រាប់នឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់កន្លែងផ្ដល់សេចក្តីកម្មក្នុងបន្ទប់សន្និការនេះវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 10:40នាទីសម្រាប់ច